next facilities committee meeting is scheduled for January 7th.
Okay, next is the finance committee. I will make a motion to approve contracts A through K. Seconded by Mr. Kraus. Questions or comments for board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. I move to approve the student activity account A. Seconded by Mrs. Walters. Questions or comments for board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. I'll make a motion to deny the request to waive school real estate tax penalty A. Seconded by Mrs. Cullen. Questions or comments for board members? Okay, I just want to share a little bit. These requests come to us not frequently, but we do get a few of these usually each year, and some of the personal situations can be really difficult. So it's very difficult for us to be in a position to not approve these, but the legal recommendation has always been not to make exceptions because then you're not being consistent across the board. And so this is something that we've struggled with for different requests that have come to us where we can really sympathize with the concerns that have come before us, but you know, we're in a position where we're supposed to deny them, and so that's why it comes to the board meeting as well. So I just wanted to point that out, and I know we've sent a letter to that effect in the past. Is that something that we can do? We'll let them know that. Any other questions or comments? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0. The next finance committee is scheduled for Tuesday, January 7th. And the next report is for the intermediate unit. Just wanted to share a few items that were shared in the board meeting from the Bucks County Intermediate Unit. First is the adult services in the workplace. The Bucks County Intermediate Unit historically has provided employability services to individuals with disabilities through age 21. Many individuals require support in the workplace after they leave the school setting. The Bucks IU proposes to expand our continuum of services to reach all adults. In order to accomplish our goal, we aspire to expand our programs to include the following services: supported employment through the Office of Developmental Programs, vocational evaluation, employment training, and employment placement assistance through the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, and a neurodiversity in the workplace program. These programs will provide education, training, and support to adults to improve their experiences and successes in the workplace. The Bucks County IU, the administration with under Dr. Hoffman, has really done a tremendous job trying to expand in all different areas to meet the needs of as many people as possible in the community, and they've really been leading the way across all of the intermediate units in the state. A second item that I wanted to point out is the Bridges Virtual, which is online learning opportunities through the IU. A partnership with Bridges Virtual, it's an online learning program powered by the IU. It allows school districts the ability to offer, develop, refine, or expand their own virtual learning program. Bridges offers solutions at the elementary, middle school, and high school levels. They also get the benefit of still being students at their home school and able to participate in activities. Districts pay a per student per class fee, so it's individualized. Bridges courses can be specially selected to ensure that each child's individual academic concerns are properly addressed on either a part-time or full-time basis, with courses available year-round. The program offers a wide range of standard and specialized courses, from foundational classes up to honors and AP courses. Courses that accommodate IEPs and 504s, and classes that meet NCAA academic eligibility requirements. Bridges also offers a full-service summer school program for acceleration, credit recovery, or enrichment. The IU is also partnered with the Upper Bucks County Technical School and their business department. Due to retirements at the Upper Bucks County Technical School, the Bucks IU has entered into a 3-year contract with them to provide business and payroll services. Teresa Holflich, Supervisor of Business Management Services, is currently assigned full-time to the Upper Bucks County Technical School, where she will oversee the business operations and work in conjunction with Susan Schechter, Supervisor of Payroll, and the Upper Bucks County Technical School leadership team to bring high-quality business administration and payroll services and supports to the Upper Bucks County Technical School. The Bucks IU has the only business office in the state to receive an award for best practices for the last 25 years in a row. Their assistance will be an asset to the Upper Bucks School. It also frees up more funds to direct to expanding programs and services for students. There has been significant interest in adding additional programs at the school, so we're excited to look into that. And the last thing that I wanted to bring to your attention, if some of you have horses, there's horse treats that are made that are called Muffins with a Mission. Daybreak Farm is the home farm of K.T. Sadbury. It's on Log Cabin Road, number 62 in Percy. They named their farm Daybreak because they believe every day is a new day, fresh and warm as the morning sun. A new chance to do something wonderful and worthwhile. They started a bakery making horse treats, Muffins with a Mission, they call it. They are giving back to our community by providing meaningful work for individuals with special needs. The bakery functions as a vocational job training site, as well as a place that individuals who already have graduated school can come and be part of the team. Their goal is to encourage and provide an environment where they can feel comfortable and have some much-needed socialization, as many do indeed have isolated lives. And their extreme generosity and caring goes beyond hiring, training, supporting, and encouraging of their associates. They also recently donated $1,000 to the Bucks IU's Education Foundation, just like our Education Foundation. You can visit their website, daybreakfarmmuffins.com, to order some muffin treats. So, hope you all can do that if any of you own horses. Okay, next is personnel. Mr. Krause is going to fill in for personnel.
Thank you. Personnel committee on November 11th. Veterans Day, and there are 4 motions to report this evening. First motion is a motion to approve certification stipends for Operations and Transportation Department employees for the 2019-2020 school year.
Second. Moved by Mr. Krause, seconded by Mr. Rice. Questions or comments from board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
I just want to give the community a sense for what that is in terms of that logistics room. And so these are 12 individuals who work as part of the operations department who have, on their own, gotten certifications that benefit the school district. So it might be for pool operations, it might be for HVAC systems, asbestos, pesticides, things that in their job are useful. And so it saves the district money. And so as part of that recognition, there is a stipend that then goes to help recognize those men and women for that. So I just wanted to let you know.
The second item is a motion to approve extended medical sabbatical leave for the second half of the 2019-2020 school year for employee number 5725.
Moved by Mr. Krause, seconded by Mrs. Cullen. Questions or comments from board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you. The next item is a motion to approve a settlement agreement for employee number 4012.
Moved by Mr. Krause, seconded by Mr. Rice. Questions or comments from board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you. The next item is a motion to approve a resolution regarding employee number 1146.
By Mr. Krause, seconded by Mrs. Cullen. Questions or All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries six zero.
Thank you. The next Personnel Committee meeting is scheduled for Monday, December 16th.
Mr. Kraus, would you like to move on to policy?
I would be happy to. Policy Committee did meet November 11th. There is one motion to the board this evening. A motion to approve first reading on policies A through D, and I'll read them, policy 004, membership, policy number 333, professional development, policy 709, building security. All three of those are revised policies. The next is policy 805.2, and that's for school police officers, and that is a new policy.
Mr. Forman? All right. Moved by Mr. Kraus, seconded by Mr. Forman. Questions or comments from board members? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries six zero.
Thank you. The next meeting is scheduled for Monday, January 6th.
Okay, technology, Mr. Rice?
All right, technology. It's never going to be technology, well, it's never going to be there. There's numbers and there's lots of technology. It's pretty cool. It's not that. At least. Mrs. Milligan, this is a presentation on 101 from middle school. I think as a school district, we're very fortunate to have devices for everybody from sixth grade all the way to 12th grade. Fortunately, we have a part of the district that is able to have that for non-parents. Thank you for the days, for the teachers and their subject that they go in, they have right there and available and accessible. So I appreciate that. This is more of a presentation, it's actually online, if you'd like to see it. It's a presentation that lots of numbers would be accidental damage protection, PDP, and some of the stuff that's going on first and months of, you know, drops, breaks, cracks, little stuff like that, you can see all the presentation. So you did a great job, so.
Our next technology committee meeting is probably on the same day, which is December 16th.
Yes.
Thank you.
So Mrs. Dolan's not here to give an update from the tech school report tonight, but we'll provide that in the report for next month. And we'll move on to the Act 48 report. Mrs. Walters?
Thank you. Act 48 finally met on Thursday, November 7th. Dr. Lavarcheck is now leading us, so it's nice to have him there, he's helped all the teachers. We discussed the seven components of effective professional development, reflected on the professional development opportunities from the previous years, and discussed ideas for the delivery of the Act 48 offerings for this year. And then we briefly looked at the dates for the 2021 district calendar and offered input for the insert. So our next meeting isn't until next year, Thursday, January 15th.
Thank you, Mrs. Walters. And the next is the Parent Area Coordinating Committee. Mr. Forman?
Thank you very much. I attended my first coordinating committee meeting on October 24th. The meeting was run by David Diamond, Township Supervisor, and Claire Black from Silverdale Borough, Ted Heinbeck from Community Center, Richard Thompson and myself representing the school district, and Wendy Ullman from the 143rd State Representative as a special guest. We had eight items on the agenda. I could go through all eight of them. Silverdale, as the Green Street project was finally completed. East Rock Hill is still working on required litigation. West Rock Hill reported on the fight for pipeline compressor station. Ben Richard Township saluted and was very happy about the waste market grant opening. And they also talked about the possible realignment of Scott and Corey Roads at 611. Percy Borough talked about the pickle courts and then stole on Second Street Parks, and that they spring, talked about the conjunction with the Township Improvement Association, holding a holiday pop-up and cola and courtesy on January 7th, from 10 to 1 p.m., and a tree lighting developed on 5 p.m. I don't know what year that is now, 101 years, 105 years? But it's over 100 years old. Representative Ullman talked about legislation to enhance efforts to support the volunteer EMS and firefighters, and suggested local vocational training opportunities for the same. Community Center reported about fundraising events, November 17th, the Holiday Cash Bash, whatever that means, December 12th, Holiday Banquet. You can find more information on their website, PennRidgeCenter.org. Dr. Thompson made a school report, introduced myself, which was itself. Talked about the forum for the Parent Education Night on Vaping, online hiring promotion for district employment opportunities, and recent board approval of the property tax rebate program for seniors, widows, widowers, and permanently disabled. The meeting concluded at 7:45. The next meeting will be January 23rd, 2020. That's my report.
Thank you, Mr. Gomez.
Mr. Gomez, it's 110 years.
There you go. I knew it was somewhere. Thank you, Mr. Gomez.
There you go. The ribbon cutting ceremony over at White's Markets, that was really opening as well. Our band played, our drum line played, and Mrs. Cullen, Mr. Cormack, Mrs. Walters, Mrs. Dolan, and myself, we all were there. So they got a nice full representation on a morning ribbon cutting ceremony. But they also donated $1,000 to our Penridge Music Program. And so I wanted to recognize that as well, because that was obviously really nice of them to do, and it was neat to see our music program get involved in the process as well. So that was a neat experience. Next is old business. Does anyone have any old business? No? Okay, new business? All right, then we are back to public comment. Any public comment?
Since we're on West Rockville Township, I was very proud of this board to pass the senior tax abatement, and also for the permanently disabled here in the district. I was looking at the information on the internet that the state publishes. Last year's abatement program's original deadline was June the 30th, but it was extended to December the 31st. So I'm kind of assuming that if somebody turns in their tax abatement forms for last year, that this board will probably match it. But beyond that, I think it would be very nice, and I'm not sure exactly how to suggest that you do this. I'm sure there's matters of privacy, and many of the households that qualify may not even have children in the district, but it would be nice if the word would get out that deadline was extended, and for the people who qualify, I'm sure they could use the assistance. So I'd like for you to try to put your heads together and come up with a way. We have, I think, about 6 weeks, and that should be a lot of time, not plenty of time, but a lot of time, so that maybe an announcement some way somehow could go out, and maybe even some of the churches with accountants in their congregations could have missions where they assist the elderly, because the instructions are like 5 pages long for a 2-page form. But so I think it might be daunting the first time for some of our residents, but I think it'd be really nice if we can, make this available and make the information available to our residents who are truly in need if their household incomes fit the criteria for that abatement, tax abatement.
So just the program was approved for next year?
Well, that's fine, but they can still qualify for the state.
Right. Okay. And so we can look at if there's ways to try to help that get, you know, publicized in a way. But you had also asked about them being able to still apply here with that if they submitted it, but it would have to be for next year. Mm-hmm. And we are working on ways to communicate either with a letter or with a notice in the bill to help bring that to people's attention who may qualify so that they know they're looking into it. So we are going to be doing that, but obviously that wouldn't help with the extension piece. So, you know, that's something, actually, it might be something where our state representatives would be able, because I know they send out monthly bulletins, so maybe our state representatives, since it's a state program, would be able to send out some kind of notification to all of them to let them know that it has been extended in case they haven't had the opportunity to do that. But I actually thought that they were accepting them late anyway, and I thought I heard that, but maybe I shouldn't say that out loud. But I thought I heard that they weren't enforcing that deadline very strictly, so.
No, maybe you shouldn't say that.
Okay, so pretend I didn't say that, but our state representatives can hopefully send that out, so we can try to reach out to them, and you know, I'd encourage you to do that as well. Any other public comments?
Hi, my name is Dan Zenzel, and I'm in Hilltown Township, and we live in the district now for about 20 years. I wanted to clarify something that my wife Cindy brought up earlier today. She was very concerned, and still is, related to a personal issue with fungus and mold in a school. But more importantly, we have a problem at an elementary school with the facilities. She works in a dish room inside the cafeteria at Grass Elementary. Last year, before leaving the school for summer, she pointed out that there was mold all over the dishwashing equipment and the ventilation system. It was supposed to be cleaned over the summer. When she returned to school, the dishwater in the dishwasher, which was used by the manager, it was actually used, was full of mold. The water was completely black and murky. The children's trays were all washed that day by the manager before my wife came in. She pointed that out, and we were told that a company called Calhoun came over and who was the people that cleaned that facility. Now this isn't the only thing. There's hand washing stations not taken care of. There's temperature controls that don't work, all in the facility. Well anyway, when Calhoun came over, my wife contacted them to see just what they did all summer. They were told that at the request of Penridge, our organizational people that were here tonight, they were told not to test the mold. They were just told to do what they can to get rid of it. When my wife pointed it out earlier in this school year, she was ambushed by people in the organization and told not to escalate the issue. So Mr. Miller, I apologize, but this can't be pushed off as a personnel issue. You have a facilities issue that has to be taken care of. These children were exposed to mold.
Mr. Sensel.
Yes, sir.
I'm afraid that we are now merging from a matter of public concern to a matter of personal concern.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Not personal. This is public because the children at Grass Elementary were exposed to mold because their dishes and trays were washed in the dishwasher that was full of mold. That is not a personal thing. That is a public issue that's involving the school district.
Thank you, Mr. Sensel.
Would you please have facilities look at what's going on and find out who told them not to test the mold?
Mr. Sensel.
As long as I'm on video, I'm fine, Mr. Moore. I'll be finished with that. But you have a problem other than personnel. And she's going to be visiting a lawyer to contact you.
Thank you, Mr. Sensel.
Yes, sir.
And thank you for turning that on. Appreciate it.
Spaces that are mentioned were tested. We did get the results back from the
tested, not the mold.
I'm sorry,
air quality was tested, not the mold. And this was 3 weeks after it was identified.
Here it is.
And there's the mold.
Thank you, Mrs. Zenzel.
Well, don't stand and say a lie without me being.
Mr. Zenzel, you're out of order, sir.
Announcements and executive sessions were held on Monday, November 11th and Tuesday, November 12th to discuss personnel and legal matters. An executive session will also be held following tonight's school board meeting to discuss personnel matters. The next school board meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, December 3rd.
Thank you.